ready to start? Okay, this presentation is we're going to explore a real world data set and we're going to use Google Refine. The Google Refine is a really neat tool that most recently has been hosted by Google and it is a free tool and it is something that you download and install locally on your desktop, so you don't need the internet in order for it to work for you. Most recently, as of October 2012, it is no longer being supported by Google, but it is still being actively supported. And so the code has all been moved to a site called GitHub, and that's where we downloaded this to the flash drives for you from. And the GitHub sites have a lot of documentation out there for you. So I'm going to teach you how to do a few things today in it, and then you'll get a chance to practice during the exercise. And then I've also, on the next slide that I'll show you, I've listed several sources for documentation that would be helpful for you if you decide to continue using Google Refine. So they have, because it's no longer supported by Google, they've rebranded it and they're calling it OpenRefine. So, it's a little confusing because the application itself that you just downloaded or that you just installed that looks like a diamond is still called Google Refine, and the next active release that they put out there, which they don't have a date on that yet, will actually be called OpenRefine. But it's essentially still the same application, it's just hosted by somebody else now. So OpenRefine is a power tool that allows you to load data, understand it, clean it up, reconcile it internally, and augment with data from other sources like Freebase or other web sources. So we're going to use this today, and we are also going to use it tomorrow. And then the exercise we do tomorrow, we'll use Freebase, or actually not Freebase, one of the other web sources. So you'll get to see an example of that too. So for the documentation, you do need the internet to get to any of their documentation. We understand since we've been here in Kenya that YouTube is blocked here in Kenya. Is it Kenya or here on the campus? We can't get to YouTube here. It's only campus? You can get to YouTube outside of campus?
Yes.
Okay, well good then. Because there are some great videos on YouTube on how to use Refine. There's some wiki documentation on the GitHub site. This was just a really interesting blog post, the third one that I read. And this was somebody who's from a journalism background, but they do a really good job of kind of explaining a lot of the different things you can do in Refine. And then they also have what they call recipes, and recipes are frequently used ideas that people use to clean up their messy data. So to get started, everyone got it installed and has it open on their desktop. So I'm going to demonstrate this first for you, and then you'll have the opportunity after we go through each one of these steps to do the exact same thing on your computer.
Using the
browser window is all messed up. Sorry about that. So the first step is I'm going to create a project by choosing a file. Loads the data, and you should have a screenshot of that on the presentation. You're following along there. And you can see the fields that are included in this data set. We have a field that they call collection code. And the data there is consistent on every record. There are 55,631 rows. So it's a big data set. And this is only half of their data set. The other half is amphibians, this is reptiles. So they have a code in here for their institution and for their collection, which is R. So this one is a little bit misnamed because they're putting two pieces of information in one field. They have a catalog number field, which they started at one, and it just keeps growing. They have a field for previous catalog number, but I don't think there's any, if much, data in it. There's a scientific name field. There are several other taxon fields, class, order, family. And then there are some location fields, continent, country, state, and county. There, across the top, you can show 5 records at a time, 10, which is what we're showing now, 25, or 50. I'm going to click on 50 so you can see more of the data. And then you can go to the next 50 records by using the next or the last buttons. The last would take you all the way to the end. So that's a little bit about how you navigate in here. So, every column has a drop-down arrow attached to it, and each drop-down arrow has a series of menus that do various things that help you clean your messy data or search for various things in your data. So remember earlier when I said it's sometimes hard to analyze your data in Excel, this is an application that could help you analyze your data better by being able to examine what is in the fields. So the first thing we're going to do, I'll demonstrate for you, is we are going to do back to the presentation. First feature that I'll review for you is the text filter. And the text filter lets you do a simple search on the data and you can see what data it will bring back. So I'm going to use the continent field. particular data set does have quite a bit of data from Africa listed in here. So I'll do a text filter, and when you click the drop-down arrow on continent and select text filter, it brings up a box to the left where you can type. So I'm going to type in continent Africa, and as I'm typing, it starts to filter the data. So it brought back 1,799 records out of the total. And then the other next thing I'm going to look for is in the country field, I'm noticing right away there are some that say unknown. So I'm going to do another text filter on the country field, which brings up another box, and I'm going to type unknown in there. And it brings up 12 records. So this might be something then that I might go back to that data provider and say, 12 records that say unknown in the country field. Is that really true? Does it need to be edited or fixed? Or is there another way that we want to present that data? And John, would we leave it as unknown, or would we prefer it to be null?
Put it as null.
So one of our standards would be that we wouldn't want this data to appear with the word unknown in there. We'd want it to just be a null field so that it would be null. So these are some just easy things you can do to start looking at your data to see areas where you might find places to clean. Now we could, at this point, remove unknown from those, but I didn't do that for this demonstration. We'll try that later. The next one, demonstration that I was going to do, you can remove the filters by clicking the X's. I click continent first to remove it, and you can see the number actually went to 586. So there are 586 records in the database with unknown in the country field. So they have some really messy data. Is how to split data into different columns. So we're going to use the collection code field this time. And I'm going to go ahead and get rid of the country filter. So in the collection code, I told you that there's two pieces of data in this column. There's an institution code in here for UTA, and then there's a collection code for R. It is possible that UTA-R might be their collection code, but they are missing the institution code. So for the purposes of this demonstration, I'm going to split these two apart for you so you can see how to split data apart. So in the drop-down for collection code, I'm going to go down to edit column, and I'm going to split it into several columns. So it asks for what piece of information in this column will allow me to split the data so it will be consistent all the way down. So by default, they put a comma in there. I know that my data in here, every record says UTA-R. So that dash is what allows me to separate the UTA from the R. So I'm going to put a dash in there, and then you can tell it how many columns you want it to split. So I just want the two, one that's going to have UTA and one that's going to have R. There's a couple of other options in here, defaults. There's, you can guess the cell type, which means it would try to determine if it's going to be a number or a text field. This is text data, so I'll just let it guess. And then you have the option to remove the column completely if this is checkmarked. So if I leave this checkmarked, we'll lose the data that says UTA-R. It will be gone. And we'll have two new columns. If I uncheck that, it would leave the UTA-R. So this would be an example of if you've got some verbatim data that you want to keep, but you want to transform that data into something else, you would consider whether or not you want to remove the verbatim data from the column. So I'll go ahead. I didn't do it this way in the presentation, but I'll uncheck it so you can see it for this. So I'll click OK, and it'll keep my original column, and it created two new columns. Now it does, if you can see the little tooltip that pops up, it renamed those columns. So we now have collection code 1, and collection code 2. You can then use the drop down in the two new fields, go to edit column, and rename the column. And I'm going to use the Darwin Board terms to rename the column. So I'm going to set it to done. Was renaming the columns. And then now the next feature I'm going to do is I'm going to add a brand new column. So talked about in the last presentation the triplet. John talked during the Dawn Core seminar about occurrence ID and when you might use that. So we're going to create an occurrence ID using the example from the Darwin Core site of URN plus the catalog plus the institution code plus the collection code plus the catalog number. So I went ahead and pre-worked out the formula on how to do that for you, and it is on step 6 of the demonstration. It's just showing the same UTA and the new value would be UTA. Well, that's not going to work for me. I need some more information in there. I want to be able to piece together three of the fields. The institution code that we just created, the collection code that we just created, and then the catalog number. tell you in a minute how I found out how to do this formula. So paste the formula in. And as soon as I paste the formula in, it shows me what value it's going to return to me for each record, gives me a preview. So I can see that it says URN, catalog, separated by colons, the institution code, the OpenTA, with the colon, the collection code of R, colon, and the catalog number. And then I'll click OK, and it performs the calculation and created a new column called occurrence ID. So how did I know how to type that formula? When I was in there, there is a help screen, and it starts to tell you a little bit about how to use that. So I know that there's one called value, and it brings back the current cell's value. There's also one called cell, and so I used a combination of the cell and the value for the cell to call the new value. So the first column, I just had text separated by, or surrounded by quotes. So I wanted to add a piece of text, then the plus symbol to add it together. Then the value of the first column, which was the UTA. And then I added more text, so each section is separated by a plus. We're creating a concatenation. And then the next section is I'm asking for the cells for the column name collection code and the value in those cells. So this is something that once you understand the formula, it's easy to find examples of this. There are lots of examples on that recipes page in the documentation. And there are a lot of different examples like this, and you can do a lot of different formulas. There are formulas for splitting data apart. I had another example here where instead of adding the columns that I did first, I actually took collection code, split it here, and turned it into this. And that formula is similar, but it had a joining things together with a plus, but it's doing a for each formula where it's splitting based on the dash. So a different method, but the same result. Okay, so that's the end of the demonstration.